integrity and infrastructure of a server as well.
Excuse me. So, from your end as well, it seems there is a lot of issues, you know, a lot of frogs that you're trying to juggle that no one can actually see from the opposition. This is a lesser focus sort of issues that they want to put on the table. Is the cost of living, is IBC, is the restoration of, the restoration of Echerera 4. So there are a lot of issues that it seems the table is so really cluttered. What do you want to come and converse with the president or the Kenya Kwanza government on?
You know, Debal, allow me to tell you that I do not even think that the church has the moral or any other ground to come and ask for dialogue. Allow me, because I know that Kenya is a country of many different faiths, but from my Christian faith, as I was reflecting on this, it was very clear to me that the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray indicates that we need, when we come as a church or as a religious group, to separate the kingdom of God, which, by the way, would never have tribalism, corruption, this kind of impunity, would never, the kingdom of God, when he says, your kingdom come. It is clear that when we are here as a church here on earth, then we need to recognize when a government that is formed by those of us who are here, who is likely to have some weaknesses, we need to see when they are not doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. My humble submission, watch right through the elections to this point, they lost it. So when you are looking for dialogue, or if you're looking for mediation, the first thing you need to do, get a mediator that the two people who are disagreeing on a point are likely to think will give them a fair hearing. I start with this because I just want to say that I have been on a journey to bring Kenya back to its glory from the referendum. Mm-hmm. And depending on how you want to look at what is happening now, you could choose to say the opposition is not clear. But I just want to come back to you and say it is very clear. The opposition is indicating what has been consistently the idea from the referendum, where we do not want this big, strong man, president, that everybody has to go to get the pie. There was the ear indication that we would want to ensure that to do this peacefully, we devolve so that we get counties. It was clear that what was bringing our country down was bad governance, a key factor of which is corruption, where nepotism, tribalism, and all kinds of isms mean that your child can go to school. You could even be of the same ethnic group. But if you don't have kitu kubwa or kitu kidogo, you're not going to go anywhere. Deba, when you look at the three things, and I just want anybody listening to try and remove, whether they call Raila phobia or Uhuru what, just come back to our country and say, what exactly is it that is the problem? The problem is, one, that we know how to talk about law. I don't know whether we talk about the spirit, I don't know whether we talk about the letter, but our behavior, our values completely disregard that. The very pronouncements that we had about election, which I don't think anybody now is fighting, because the opposition is saying, one, open the server. The point, the reason why we want to open the server, if you've listened to the Honorable Raila Molo speak as he addresses those who turn up for demonstration, is that the gazettement that was done did not capture the constituencies, which are supposed to be the units that should have been there. Why? Instead, it was counties. Now, listen, look at that. That is questioning adherence to the law, integrity, and values. When you come to the idea of cost of living, it is because it is clear that the organ, we have three arms of government. The one that should have been, whose responsibility is oversight, representation, and legislation, somehow has decided to decide they are an extended arm of the executive. And this is not that I am putting this like in a bad light as such, I know in 2007 to 2012, we did have a situation where the opposition was the majority in parliament. We also, I might humbly say, had a speaker that stood and enabled the country to have some form of hope. I don't know what you think, but when I look now and I see the manner in which the executive somehow has decided that it is an extension of the legislature, and you see members of parliament beginning to feel that they can on their own get development from State House, I look at the two houses, I don't see, maybe you can tell me if you do, I don't see what we could see then in 2008 that Marende was able to sort of take that seat and help Kenyans to see that there is going to be some form of hope of going forward. So I just want to say that I think what Kenyans must do is to get away from this feeling where they label and lock certain people in a box. I know today when we are here with the Honorable Dr. Nyikal, there would be people who would look at us and say, okay, those are, they would think either of political affiliation or they would think of ethnic affiliation. Dibal, this is one thing I have fought. And I know from the time I joined the referendums fight in 2005, all the way to even getting into political parties, we have had the Honorable Raila Amolo Odinga consistently fight that we take away this ethnic, tribal, exclusion, division. And if you listen to what it is that he says at the moment, when he talks about the IEBC and he talks about how we need to make sure that those that we put to bring this should be seen to be representative, that's consistent with trying to get a country that will be held by integrity, will be held by respect, and will allow everybody. When you look at the cost of living, it is also simply saying we cannot have a situation where you have this 50 CASs, a number of whom are people with all due respect, have already served and might have had something that they could even fall back on, and you have people who can hardly buy unga, and you have people who can hardly even make ends meet. You are saying that we are getting to a point where you have priorities of the government seem to be much more going to look for those who would help in 2027. So I just want to humbly submit that if anyone in this country truly loves Kenya, they will see that there is nothing that is coming that we have not seen in the past and we did not fight. We fought impunity. We fought the strong man syndrome where there was only one person, mama na baba. We fought tribalism where it was said that if your name begins with O, I do know, I have taught at USIU, I taught intercultural communication. And I know that there are children who even did not want their names to begin with O. So we have fought all this. And honestly, in 2003, in the elections, we celebrated. And we could see how we moved with the coalition, despite all these things. We celebrated. We can see how we moved, even from 2013. We celebrated. We can see how, despite everything, we moved from 2018. What we are seeing right now, Dibal, is really something all Kenyans need to wake up to. We have a situation where the very organs that are intended, that we fought so hard to be responsive to the interests of the people, have decided or have been boxed in. And that's why we have the people coming up.
But you know, they're calling for time. They're saying, you know, how then do you expect all this development to happen within a short span of time? You should give us peace, devoid of demonstrations, so that we can actually have space to work.
If you just allow me, just allow me for 1 minute. Just before the Honorable Dr. Nyikal comes in, do you need time to recognize that you cannot have those who you would want to constitute the IEBC to be imbalanced? Do you need time? Do you need time to recognize that all you need to do is to say on this matter, okay, let's suspend it? Because you cannot say that you need time, but you're busy bulldozing and pushing bills. You are saying you need time, but you go and you
but
come
the big,
up with...
the big ticket issue is the cost of living.
Yes,
how, but... How do we turn around? How do we make, you know, the economy to thrive and give it space to grow as well if we are stifling with demonstrations, business not being opened? An estimation of 2 billion shillings a day is being lost, according to the deputy president. You have another day on Thursday, right, that you want to add?
Because it is better, if you just allow me to say this, it is better to have a peaceful voice that is calling the red flag that Kenya is going through a slippery slope than to be quiet. The same deputy governor, the same deputy president who is talking about those billions, ask him what happened on the highway. How did those people come in? Is anyone going to do business when they see young men wielding pangas? Ask him, is anyone going to get into the CBD when police are all around? This is what they call doublespeak. The only red flag that we have in this country right now is that we have a government that is playing politics and is not holding leadership. And if we can get to recognize the very recognition that that government was put in office by the people, and we can allow the people peacefully to demonstrate, you would see that there will be a difference.
But when you talk of double speak, I come to you, Dr. Nyika. When you talk of double speak, I wonder also what you feel on the other side of Azimio when you're telling Kenyans to sabotage some of the products that we know it is helping their lives. Also, most people are employed by some of